proposed to keep them going through the winter period when the courses are less profitable and have a lower footfall. If the council is unable to move quickly enough for the 1st of April transfer to happen, what support can they give to new operators so that they do not have to shoulder the burden, the financial burden, of either having to take over a course during less profitable times as new operators or taking over the course following a period of closure when the course has been left fallow?
Thanks for that. I'm going to invite Councillor Cameron to respond to that question as this falls within her committee.
Thanks, Chair. Thank you, Ms Marshall. Thank you for attending and asking this. And on a personal note, I appreciate you put a lot of time and effort in over. I was elected almost 3 years ago, and this has never come off the agenda. And you've represented lots of groups, and it can't be easy. And the uncertainty has always been difficult. The point you've raised is really important. I raised it in a workshop with the members of the committee, and there was lots of agreement that the timelines were tight. But in terms of the formal response about the process, I'm happy to give you that now, and then that will go into the minutes that will be published. If the council agrees the budget proposal on the 28th of February, the relevant director, following discussions with the senior leadership team, will make an operational decision of to suspend the provision of the service on the 1st of April, pending a formal decision by the Tourism Community's Cultural Leisure Committee. Once the consultation on the courses concludes, the relevant committee will then decide to keep the courses closed on a permanent basis to deliver the budget saving or decide an alternative proposal. If the committee decides on an alternative proposal, which may include transfer of the courses, the committee will task the relevant director to progress this. However, the committee would need to identify how the saving is to be made still within that relevant total budget. The timelines which cannot be yet determined. If a proposal is then agreed that the courses will be operated by a third party, this will be at no cost to the council. That answer will go into the minutes.
Thank you for that, Keith. I'm going to invite the second speaker up now, which is Daniel Keane.
Thank you. My name is Danny Keane. I'm past captain of Bradford Golf Club. The question is, if the proposal does not go ahead and the council retains the golf service in-house for all four courses, what plans will it introduce to ensure the service reduces or eliminates the golf subsidy? Given that, in 2019, the council made a commitment following a full scrutiny review into the service of golf to invest using capital money into the courses to bring them up to a standard over the next 8 years that is presentable and, in my view, attractive to people using the service, thus having the potential for increased income. Will the council hold itself to that commitment in improving the quality of its services, given the two STRI commissioned reports that clearly indicated the issues several years ago?
Thank you, Mr. Keane. Thank you for attending in person to ask this question. Thank you. You've referenced the scrutiny, and I signed what we call a call-in to really scrutinise the decision that was being taken at the time, which is why part of the recommendations were these STRI reports, and I can appreciate there were certain elements of that that included investment. In my personal opinion, I felt that investment was very much a catch-up. I felt there had been an underinvestment, which may have been to do with other courses and other high priority things. But in terms of this budget process, I'm happy to explain to you the process that we go through now, particularly around that proposal. Irrespective of the outcomes of the budget proposals, and following an exercise to compare Wirral's golf fees and the charges of other municipal courses or the providers of golf, the service is proposing to introduce a new pricing model that will seek to reduce the subsidy. This includes those users accessing the service through the Invigorate scheme. Some capital investment on the golf courses has already been undertaken, including the improvement of some greens and some health and safety work, which was identified in those STRI reports. criteria for capital spend includes a requirement to demonstrate that the return on investment will recover repayments of any capital borrowing. While some degrees of increased income may be achieved through course improvements, if the general decline in golf participation that we've seen in recent years and the impacts of seasonality and the price increases with the current oversupply of municipal courses we have, it means that it may not be guaranteed that we can cover the capital costs. The council cannot therefore commit to invest in the courses from which there may not be a level of return to cover the cost of that investment. That answer will obviously go into the minutes for you. And then subsequently, you're welcome to come to the Tourism and Curiosities Culture Leisure Committee and we can pursue it there.
Robin Clark, and Robin, I invite you to ask a question. Thank you.
Good evening, councillors. My name is Robin Clark. I am currently the treasurer of Grafton Golf Club. My question this evening is, if the council decides to proceed on the proposed budget, and Hoy Lake and Bracknell are earmarked for closure, will they commit to a transition plan with regards to a potential new operator to take over the course? It may take some time, clearly, for that to happen, which is understood, but a golf course that closes and then possibly reopens under a new operator 3 months, 4 months, 6 months, is not a viable business model for anybody.
Councillor Cameron again, thanks.
Thanks, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Keane. Thank you for your question. Thank you for attending. Again, this is a particular point I raised in the workshop. The workshop is cross-party, and I'm aware that some of my exact phrases are coming back as public questions, but it's very pertinent. The seasonality around golf is part of the difficulty we have when you're playing to conditions as well, and I understand that. The seasonality in the last 2 years is very difficult to gauge because of the situation we've been in, and a lot of the data I've seen is prior to the pandemic. So the finances and the data and the usage data that we've been trying to interrogate is all prior to the pandemic. And I feel that the transition period is really tight. Not least of all that, Bracknell's been in constant discussion, but Hoy Lake, this has come out of nowhere because of a situation I inherited, several people inherited. So I am very concerned about the timeline being so tight, and I will, at committee, through the committee system, really try to work hard on this. In terms of the formal response around the process, the relevant director, following discussions with the senior leadership team, will make an operational decision whether to suspend the provision of the service on the 1st of April, pending a formal decision by the Tourism Communities Culture and Leisure Committee. If the director takes this decision, there will be no continuity of service within the transition period. That's the formal response, and that will be limited.
Just a follow-up question, or perhaps a follow-up comment. If the course were to close, the courses were to close on the 1st of April, people will make their decisions, either quit golf entirely, which I don't think is in anybody's best interest, or to move on and join other clubs, potentially move to other council golf courses, but in all likelihood, a lot of them will give up the game. So I'll repeat how important it is, in my opinion, that the council commit to a transition period if there is viable options on the table. Because of course the closes for a period of time is not a viable option for any provider. Thank you.
Thank you. On a personal note, I agree, and particularly the 1st of April, and particularly when you would consider really getting out playing more often, if the course condition deteriorates in April, then it's difficult to get it back. So I'm very cognizant of the timing being off, but it's the way financial years work.
Thank you. Question four is Jackie Watts. If you'd like to come and ask the question.
attend the meeting this evening and ask my question. My name is Jackie Watts and I'm here as a local resident and a user of Brackenwood Golf Course. I'd just like to ask, what assurances can the council give that if the proposal isn't agreed and Brackenwood and Hoylake remain open and in council control, that in 12 months' time these courses will not be under the same level of scrutiny again, with all the uncertainty that this brings to residents, clubs, societies and the general public that play and use these courses?
Thank you, Mrs. Watts. Thank you for question. Thank you for coming tonight to ask that question. No assurances can be provided to this effect. And it pains me to say that because the uncertainty in the short time that I've been a councillor has been pretty brutal, not least of all. When I was elected, the first thing I found out was there were some plans for Hoylake that I then couldn't talk about. That has overshadowed municipal golf. It has made all of those issues play into the provision of municipal golf, and I think the uncertainty has been cruel. I accept that when third-party operators take over, sometimes the clubs are sidelined, and it's the clubs and the history that you want to retain, and you can't guarantee that with third-party operators that they will allow you to still play as a club with your own setup. But unfortunately, in terms of the councillors, the operator of the municipal courses, I can't give you any assurances. Sorry for that.
Can I just comment on that and ask, would it be in everybody's interest then at this point to allow an asset transfer of a suitable alternative operator that was agreeable on all sides?
So that is part of the process we can enter into once we've got through this difficult budget savings process. It's a process that has very strict timelines of protocol. We have to go through it. We have a fiduciary duty to set a balanced budget. And then we can look at everything else beyond that. But unfortunately, we have an intense level of observation of what we're up to. We have to set this balanced budget. But I'm happy to meet with you personally. We can discuss all kinds of options once we've got through this hurdle. Thank you.
Question 5 is from Anne Edwards, so if you'd like to step up and ask your question, Anne, thank you.
Hello, first of all, I'd like to just introduce myself. My name is Anne Edwards. I'm actually Vice Captain of the Brackenwood Ladies section at the moment. Thank you for giving me the permission to ask this question. Brackenwood Golf Club leases their clubhouse from the council and has spent many thousands of pounds to upgrade and redecorate various parts of the building following the confirmation last year that the courses were not due to close for closure. What support will the council offer to ensure that if the courses close and no alternative operator can be agreed, clubs with leases with the council will not be expected to pay the remainder of their leases should they be forced to close as a golf club through no fault of their own?
Thank you, Mr. Edwards. Thank you for coming this evening. Thank you for your question. On a personal note, I was disappointed when we were given the impression that these courses would never close. Because this is a structural deficit. This has built up over years and years of busting the budgets through the roof. Structural deficit has to be resolved. So if you were given this time, during this process, some kind of guarantee that they wouldn't close, I can only apologise for how you may have been misled on that, because this has always been brought forward as a saving proposal we have to look at. I appreciate you put a lot of time and effort into the clubhouse, and that, you know, is definitely something that we take into account. But if a decision is ultimately taken to close the golf courses, then negotiations will be entered into with the golf clubs in relation to the termination of the leases.
Can I ask then if we, I don't feel as though you've answered the question, to be perfectly honest. And I would just like to say, are we expected to pay for the lease of how long it's going for or not? Or what would be the timelines on the advice of when we would know?
Okay, thank you. Because no decision has yet been taken on this budget proposal, we would be preempting everything to start that level of detail just yet. So we just have to set a balanced budget, and then all of the other elements that people are concerned about, we can start having those detailed discussions. And I'm happy to meet with yourself and Mrs. Watts. You can meet with the senior leadership team and work these things through.
Just to follow on from that, of course, it will be a meeting with officers as well, as yourself.
Sorry?
The meeting will be with officers as well, as yourself. Just to let all residents. Just clarify.
Sorry, just to correct, I may have said it quite quickly. I said I'm happy to meet with the senior leadership team on that.
Thank you. Question six, I think you'll be all on with that, Alice.
Thank you, Chair. This is a question from Anne Litherland, who could not be here. She asks, I took part in your Have Your Say consultation on the tennis centre, but have realised since then that there was no mention of the gym or alternative provision for those who use the gym in this consultation. As the gym is used extensively by the local participants in the weight management programme, what will happen to them when the gym closes?
Thank you. I assume a copy of this will go directly to Ms. Little, and then I'm happy to read out a response now. Mrs. Little, thank you for your question. The final designs for the tennis centre are still being worked through and design consultants, and we have recognised that the need to retain a fitness facility will provide benefits for the final offer and the delivery of our programmes, and could likely be considered potentially retained independently of the design for the broader gymnastics and soft play proposal.
So we move on to question seven, and that's Jonathan White, if you want to come and ask that.
Good evening, everybody. This is my question. At the end of March 2022, Wirral Council is forecast to have £64.8 million in reserves, of which £13.6 million is unrestricted general fund balances for a rainy day, and £51.2 million are earmarked reserves. There is evidence available that at least £5 million of reserves have not been used over the past few years and are no longer needed. Can the committee outline clearly to me what the £51.2 million in earmarked reserves is for?
Thank you. So I'll respond to that one. The general fund balance position of £13.6 million forms part of the 2022-23 budget proposal discussion at this evening's meeting. The forecast position for the end of March 2022, however, is for a retained balance of £10.7 million. The general fund balance is in place to support the financial sustainability of the council and is held to absorb financial impacts that could be felt from emergency situations or other unexpected costs that may arise. Individually marked reserves held for specific directly related activity, along with the forecast position of each of them to the end of March 2022, are provided in the Quarter 3 Budget Monitoring Report, which is shown in the papers for this evening's agenda as Item 6. There are 48 earmarked reserves in question with an approximate forecast value of £24 million. In addition to these directorate-related earmark reserves, the Council expects to hold £15 million in reserves at financial year-end on behalf of schools. The Council also holds organisation-wide earmark reserves to manage government grants received as compensation for business rates relief applied to bills because of decisions made by central governments, as well as funds received to support the response to the COVID-19 pandemic, grant monies received in respect of the local income tax guarantee, which relates to both council tax and business rates income. Reserve position is also maintained for insurance-related matters. Approximately £29.6 million is forecast to be held at year-end across these organisation-wide items. Just to add to that as well, the subject of earmark reserves has been looked at and scrutinised extensively as part of this budget setting process. And we are satisfied that there's nothing in those reserves that we can take out and use for anything else. And it's worth noting that if we didn't have reserves a few years ago, the likes of the new ferry explosion, we wouldn't have been able to have responded to at the time. So I think really whilst it's on the face of it, you say that there's money in reserves, that they can't be used. They can't be used to plug a hole in revenue budgets.
Yeah, thanks for that answer. If I just follow up a little bit, if I heard correctly, then I think the position was 29.6 million in reserves. And to actually balance the budget this year, I think, is about 2.6 million. So do we really need to be making cuts to people's, to local people's services based on local need?
Yeah, I think the question has been answered about reserves.
Thank you very much.
Next question eight is John Jones. John, do you want to ask it?
Is with cuts being made to leisure centres, libraries, and £200,000 in youth provision cuts, how do the council propose that these cuts won't impact on the mental health of our young people even further? Will we not see an increase in antisocial behaviour and further costs to the local authority and other services such as the NHS and the police?
I'm going to
bring
Councillor Wendy Clancy to respond to that one. No.
Thanks, Chair. So
sorry, was it yourself?
It comes across to your committee, so we will both respond. We'll respond in two parts because there's a couple of ideas being conflated here. I'll address the libraries element and then my colleague will address the other. In terms of libraries, the library service data indicates that the current baseline usage for age groups 30 to 17 and 18 to 24 year olds represents 3.24% of current users. Whilst this does not indicate a high level of need amongst this demographic, the new model and library strategy is dedicated to ensuring we increase engagement and provide a service based on current and future need. Shared programmes of work will be developed in targeted areas to support literacy and independent reading. This will be a primary role of the team of librarians to support. For the five non-staff libraries listed, which are in the more deprived areas, discussions will be held with the organisation where the library is co-located to ensure that the space and IT facilities are available. These libraries will still be supported by staff on an ad hoc basis to ensure we meet the aims and objectives of the library strategy and to ensure that stock and equipment is up to date and in working order. This is the model that is about to be piloted in Seacombe's Children's Centre.
And to speak to the element of the question which relates to children's services, obviously mental well-being is very important for all ages, including our children and young people. But the reduction of £100,000 from the council budget to the Hive Youth Zone is being offset by £100,000 donation from local business regeneration. And in the short term, that's going to mitigate against potential reduction of services for young people. In the long term, the Hive Youth Zone is increasing its own capacity for fundraising and it will work in partnership with the local authority to increase external grant income. In the 2021-22 budget setting process, the council invested additional funding into its own youth services. Over £100,000 of this funding was allocated for weekend activity, which was surplus to the core youth offer. That we were very close to propose it at the time. So the proposal now is that we will have to regretfully cease this additional activity and protect the core neighbourhood offer, which we'll continue to deliver with the existing resource of highly experienced and skilled staff. Wirral Youth Collective, a collaboration of organisations providing activity for young people, will continue to work together to secure funding from grant streams such as the Youth Endowment Fund, Violence Reduction Partnership and Safer Streets Initiative to help provide positive experiences and diversionary activities for young people. Thank you.
Thank you. We have one more question left, I think. Councillor Joe Baird, you've got a question? question was.
Thanks very much. I'm the my name is Jo Bird. I'm the independent councillor for Bromborough and New Ferry. And last year, Wirral Council was one of nine councils who asked the government for exceptional financial support, despite Wirral having £140 million in reserves in the bank. And the repayments and the interest on these loans are to be repaid over 20 years, and Wirral asked for about £20 million, over the 2 years, last year and this year. And as things turned out, the full amount was not required. Last year, about £6.5 million was borrowed, and it's forecast for around £6.5 million to borrow this financial year. And at the time, we didn't know the terms and conditions of the loan, but we do now. And it's an option, I think, to do like councils like Nottingham and Peterborough, who've decided not to take down the second loan. That's a political decision, a choice that they've made, because taking a loan makes it harder to fund frontline services for the next 20 years with the loan repayments and interest on that. So my question is, how much money next year and each year would be taken out of revenue income as a result of taking down the second loan?
Okay, thanks for your question. Councillor Bird, the response is the council was to draw down 6.4 million capitalisation for 21-22. The impact would be for 22-23, £457,300. Each year from 2023 to 24 to 2041-42 is a different amount, decreasing from £452,383 in 2022-23-24 to £378,847 in 2041-42. I'm happy to circulate those figures to you.
Thank you. The supplementary question, if I may. So that's between, I heard, around £378,457 a year taken out of revenue as a result of drawing down their loan, which doesn't seem a very responsible decision to me. Given the reserves that are in the bank, there are earmarked reserves there, and you mentioned the reserves that were there for emergencies like New Ferry explosion. That's the ward I represent. And there was a motion at full council proposed by one party and defeated by another, proposed by the Conservatives, defeated by Labour, to draw down, to use emergency reserves to make hardship payments for people that were affected by the explosion, a very direct use of reserves. It wasn't used for that, it was just left there in the bank until years later. It was that a while later it was drawn down and was paid out as hardship payments. So it seems like earmarked reserves can be used.
Sorry,
can be
decided. Got a supplementary question to what you're actually asking.
Yeah, it's about the earmarked reserves. They can be used when the politicians want them to be, some of them, or as a political choice not to be used for them. And I've asked this question in private, I'll ask it now in public, about the earmarked reserves. What amount of the earmarked reserves would be legal?
So the question you asked was about capitalisation. So
yeah.
You've already had a question on earmarked reserves.
Uh-huh. And this question hasn't been asked or answered in public. It's what amount of the earmarked reserves would be legal to reallocate to use for other things? We've heard what they're preferred to use, but not what's legal to use.
So you've asked me something that you haven't submitted prior.
Uh-huh.
As a supplementary, and I'll get that information to you after this meeting. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
So thanks everyone anyway for the questions that you brought to the committee tonight. Any information that's outstanding that's been requested tonight, I'll ensure that it is sent out. So we'll move on to the next agenda item, which is statements and petitions. We've got a number of petitions. The first one is around the Church and Leisure Centre, so I'm going to invite the petitioner, Stephen Bennett, to present your petition. You've got 1 minute to speak to this. Thanks, Stephen.
Thanks very much for allowing me to present this petition of over 5,000 signatures on behalf of the local community to save budget at the Leisure Centre. When I say the local community, I do not just mean Dinglewood Church. Residents of the Leisure Centre, who have served not only that, the this area, but it's Beechwood, Octorum, Over Church and Prenton as well. As the 16 schools that were using it before, it was temporarily closed to accommodate the vaccine centre, which is another environment we use for the community. Those schools that use the centre prior to the closure would have to travel further afield in order to give children vital swimming lessons at the cost of already stretched school budgets. Those areas I mentioned before have families on low incomes that cannot afford to travel to other areas and gain access to leisure facilities, which would deprive families most in need of a vital resource. Although it has been stated that this centre receives big subsidies, it has not had any major investment in over 10 years. For example of this would be it's the only leisure centre not to have any money put into a gym as a money-making scheme. Its facilities, please consider this proposal to close, reconsider the proposal to close the centre. Say thanks.
Thanks for that. Thanks for keeping to time, Mr. Pat. Okay. We've got another petition now. I'm going to invite it to our Rock Bay Library and Councillor Nolan, you'll now present to you too. Thanks.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, I've got near a petition of over 1,000 signatures from Rock Ferry residents in respect of the proposal to close the library. Rock Ferry is one of our most deprived wards, not only the most deprived wards in this borough, but the most deprived wards in England. It's in the top 2% in terms of deprivation. And the library is really, really important for people. And I was actually quite surprised the number of people when they were signing this petition who were telling me that they use this library and need to use the library to have access to computers, because so many people in Rock Ferry don't have access at home to internet facilities, and it's really, really important. It also serves 5 primary schools. There are regular children's groups going on in that library all the time. There's a community garden being developed back of that library, and it is an absolutely vital community resource. There's some really exciting plans for the community hall, which is adjacent to the library, so it's vital in a community that has very, very little, that we don't take any more steps to deprive that community any further. Given that we have a will plan which says we will work towards getting rid of our inequalities. And I hope that this committee, when we come to debate later on the agenda, libraries will look sympathetically on the proposal to close Rock Ferry Library and rethink it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor Nolan. Their petition, which is on Residence Park and at Tramway Road, is in St. Bree's in Frampton, and the petitioner is Julianne McGough. So could you come and present your petition, speak to it, and apologise if I haven't got it correct. Thank you.
You got it right. I'm actually submitting petitions on behalf of Prenton. I'm also Paul Jobson of Birkenhead and Tramway, who can't be present tonight, but he did request a submission of the petition. The residents of Prenton and Birkenhead and Tramway who have signed the petition would like the council to understand how both unfair the charge is, but also how it works against the green aims of Wirral Council. First, the facilities are used by far more than the residents in the immediate area. In the case of Tramway Rovers Football Club, it is accessed by all of Wirral. Furthermore, it brings health and financial benefits to the whole borough, as discussed by council in 2018, when wishing to strengthen ties with the club. Additionally, residence parking encourages fans and shoppers to use public transport, thereby meeting the aims of the council to decrease carbon footprint. The charge for parking will not stop residents buying cars, but it will hit families already facing a cost of living crisis. We strongly state that the cost of these facilities should not be faced by the people who wish only to park outside their door. A number of residents have suggested a better route would be to enforce the residents' parking through fines of those who park where they shouldn't.
Thank you for that. Petition Petition number four is on Prenton Library, and that's Alan Dollery. So if you'd like to come up and speak to that, we've got a minute, Alan. Thank you.
Concern of the community is that we have nothing at all in Prenton Dell whatsoever. We've got the children's children's park, and that's it. In 2009, we protested against the closure of the library then, and we were successful, thank God. The library plays an important part on our estate now. It will be a place for communication, especially after the COVID had happened. It will be a place where the youngsters can go for the homework lessons. We have the toddlers club there, was very successful. It's used by two schools for the children to learn further education. And it is a vital part of the estate. If that was to go, our estate would be nothing, because the bus services, they can't get a bus to Birkenhead unless they want to go to New Ferry first and then down. The old age pensions have to walk half a mile to Woodchurch Road to get a bus down to the nearest library. So I'd like the councillors to think of the position the Prenton Dell estate is, because it will be, and it has been, a great asset. Thank you.
Fifth petition is it's already been handed in. It's a petition around proposed 12 month closure of Brixton Town Centre and loss of three of the Royal Tennis Courts, so that's been already handed in for us. Do you know how many signatures are on there? Okay. So that's the petition. Sorry, Councillor Clements.
Thank you, Chair. I've been passed a petition that's titled Save Grimsby Library, and it says the purpose of this petition is to object to the closure of this very well-used facility. It's not just a well-used library, but a meeting space for individuals and groups. It provides a welcoming and safe space for social interaction and for combating loneliness and isolation, plus a place of learning. And in the light of the comments we discussed earlier about mental well-being, I think it speaks to that. Thank you very much. There's 2,800 signatures.
Thank you, Councillor Clements. So we move on to the next agenda item, which is statements. We have one statement from Unison, and it's going to be Danielle that will speak to this. Thank you. You've got up to 3 minutes, thanks.
Thank you, Chair. Wirral Unison have read the savings proposals held a series of meetings with officers to discuss the implications of them. We recognise that the financial situation the council finds itself in is a result of more than a decade of government austerity and local government funding cuts. The impact has perhaps been exacerbated by COVID, albeit with additional grants received and the implications of the decision to seek a capitalisation directive. Our first call upon the council is that there are no compulsory redundancies of our members as a result of this budget. No one should be forced out of employment for circumstances beyond their control. We also remained concerned about the well-being of the workforce that remains with the council. This is a workforce that strives to maintain essential services throughout the pandemic. It cannot be expected that few staff can keep being asked to deliver more. Our members, however, are not just deliverers of council services, they're part of our community. We welcome that since the P&R committee last met, the council have withdrawn proposals in relation to the park services and school crossing patrols, and it is good that councils are listening. But we would like to ask you to listen further. A number of proposals regarding leisure and libraries are subject to consultation that will continue for some weeks after decisions are made tonight on the future of those services. We are told those services will close on the 1st of April, pending the outcome of the consultation. Is this consultation meaningful? For instance, if a golf course no longer used or maintained from April until mid-June, that has a significant impact upon its future viability. We believe that not only are these services valued by the community, but in many cases can be income generating. The rope fund pool is a case in point. By the council's own figures, this pool can generate at least three times the income as the gym proposed to replace it. And that is on the basis it's only opened during the 6 week school summer holidays. Woodchurch Leisure Centre can also be viable and income generating within the council. We know that there is more demand for swimming lessons than Wirral can meet with the current capacity, and a more focused business plan would be more successful. The sheer scale of library closures will have astounded many. Rather than focusing on enhancing the use of these community facilities, the easier option of closure is proposed. A relatively vague proposal for a mobile library will not fill this gap. We know that 66% of people walk to the library, yet in Birkenhead, where roughly half the population do not have access to a car, only one library will be left. It proposes to close, for example, the library in Rockferry, an area of high deprivation, and a library that has five primary schools in its catchment area. We ask the council to think again on these proposals, equating to roughly £2 million, and instead look at how these services can add value to communities, protect jobs and bring income to the council. Thanks, Danielle. Cheers.
So we've got no questions by members that have been received, so we can move on to the next agenda item, which is budget and performance management. And this is our budget monitoring quarter three report, and that's going to be presented by Chair.
Thank you, Chair. So the report sets out, quarter three monitoring report sets out the budget monitoring position as a result of quarter three, which is the end of December 2021. And this position is a further improved position from that reported at the end of quarter two, of a further 849,000 favourable variance. Members will remember at quarter two that as a result of the additional grant funding that we received and a small favourable variance reported at that time, the value of the capitalisation request made to the Department for Levelling Up Housing and Communities, or DLUHC as I will refer to it for the rest of the evening, was able to be reduced from the initial request of 10.7 million to 7.2 million. And as a result of the further improved position that we see at quarter three, the request can be further reduced now to 6.355 million. And this is as a result of a number of factors. So in the Adult Care and Health Directorate, it's broadly forecasting a similar position to quarter two, and that was a small favourable variance of around just under £500,000. And this was mainly as a result of vacancy savings, and reduced costs where a small cohort of providers are yet to actually sign up to the real living wage. Within the Children, Families and Education Directorate, there's been an